Good morning, everyone. I'm Elisabeth Menon from Échangeur, BNP Paribas Personal Finance. Welcome to this new What's Hot In, a short review focused on retail news facing the coronavirus crisis. We were in New York City 1 month ago with Bertrand Leseigneur, our local retail innovation correspondent. Today, let's go to Singapore. I'm pleased to welcome Martin Pasquier, co-founder and CEO of Innovation is Everywhere agency. Welcome, Martin. And thanks to be with us today.
Thank you very much for the invitation.
And for those of you who are loyal readers of the Échangeur's newsletter, Martin and Céline share with us each month a new innovation from Asia. For instance, Céline visited a new car dealer, Niahos, I don't know if the pronunciation is very good, in Shanghai. And we will publish a very interesting article about Ninja Card, an Indian startup. Today, Martin will focus on Singapore, that is one of the most innovative economies in the world. We will see how retailers are adapting and introducing new measures during the coronavirus crisis. So Martin, now the floor is yours.
Okay, thank you very much, Elisabeth. Good afternoon or good morning to everyone, based on depending on where you are. Just give me a second to share the presentation. I think you should be able to see it now. So welcome. So we'll spend the next 30 minutes together to go through what Singapore has done in terms of reaction to the COVID-19 crisis, both from a government and a retailer perspective. I am still confined as of today. It's been about a bit more than 2 months, and I have one more month to go before the phase two kicks in, and then I'm allowed to not only go outside and see my family, but also have some dinner with my friends. So I'm really looking forward to it. So the way I'm going to show this presentation, I want to do maybe a quick introduction on ourselves and after on Singapore. Basically, we help different companies, including L'Échangeur, to source inspiring trends, from all over the world, in particular Asia. We are very convinced that Asia is a great source of knowledge today because it's very dynamic. There's a lot of growth, a lot of technology adoption as well in China, in South Korea, in Singapore, in Indonesia. And those markets are very interesting, I think, to look at in terms of, you know, what can we get inspired from a retail or technology perspective. We are really convinced as well that every country in the world has a specificity when it comes to innovation. And we like to go into those different markets, you know, with our little handphones, interviews, and going to key events to really understand the backstage of innovation so that we can get fresh information. And that's why my colleague Céline is often going to all these new stores to report for you guys. We work for many industries, but I think that will be all for the bragging rights, and we're going to kick off directly for the table of content. So I'm just going maybe to do a quick introduction on Singapore, because you might not be very familiar. It's a very small country. We are 5.5 million inhabitants, a small island located just here, 200 kilometers north of the equator. We are stuck between Malaysia and Indonesia. The country has been ranked number 3 in innovation capacity by a ranking last year done by Bloomberg and other organizations. It's a mix of R&D spending, a mix of the share of technology in the GDP, etc., etc. You know, Singapore has no natural resources, so they have tried their best for the last 50, 60 years to become a hub of whatever new tech is, happening in the market. They are very strong in fintech, in smart city, in pharma, in biotech, in oil and gas, you name it. So there's really a lot of things to learn from that yet a very small country. It's also a country which is located strategically in a new region of the world that we call Southeast Asia. It's about 11 countries, from Myanmar here to Indonesia, all these islands over here, to Philippines, Thailand, Vietnam, Malaysia, etc. A very interesting region of about 625 million inhabitants, most of whom are entering the middle class for the last 10, 15 years. In Indonesia alone, for example, it's a country of 250 million people, and every year, 10 million new people enter the middle class, and of course, they want to consume luxury, travel, education, more sophisticated goods and services. And of course, all this population is pretty young and mobile only, mobile first. So that's what makes it very interesting. We are only 4 hours from India, from Hong Kong, from Australia. So it's really a very interesting region. I tend to compare it sometimes to Europe in the sense that it's exciting. It's a mosaic of different countries. They don't all look the same, but you still have a common background in terms of cooking. We all love spicy food in those countries. And in terms of the youth of the different countries. And Singapore is really at the center here. So very interesting place to watch and observe everything that happens around us. Singapore is also one of the most dynamic ecosystem. It's a mapping that I love to show from MasterCard. And they were trying to rank countries based on the dynamism of the ecosystem. So they were ranking, how many VCs are in each country, how many exits, how many IPOs, how many tech startups. And on that scale here, from bottom to top, it's a scale of how digital is that country in terms of number of smartphones, number of people doing e-commerce, doing e-payments, and Singapore stands out. So it's one of the countries with the highest penetration of digital for the population, and also one of the countries with a very fast and dynamic ecosystem in terms of startups and innovating in very different fields. So, and you can see all the countries in red are in Asia, so they are either standing out or breaking out. So if you want to look for innovation, Asia is definitely a very good place of the world to look at for the moment. Singapore has been very tech-friendly for a while. Half of the island is now open for testing for autonomous taxis. Smart hospitals have been all the rage recently for the contactless delivery of drugs and different pills to avoid the contact because of the COVID. Vertical farming is very hot too. We are in a very small country with very scarce land. And of course, we need to feed a few million people, so it has been very popular as well. And fiber has been installed all over the island with very fast speeds of 180 Mbps. So again, that allows all the population to be highly connected and to benefit from different types of services. It's also a place, Singapore, which is halfway between the West and the East. It used to be a former British colony, and before that, you used to have some Dutch influence as well. Now it's really trying to be both the friends of China and the US, which is not easy every day. But you will see the Google, Apple, Facebook, Amazon everywhere in Singapore. But the Alibaba ecosystem is not very far. They're not really present under their own brand in Singapore. But they have invested, for example, in the largest e-commerce platform of Singapore called Lazada. It's the Amazon of Southeast Asia, and it's now fully owned by Alibaba. So even though they are not here by their own name, they still hold a big part of the share of e-commerce in the region. In terms of retail, a few innovations I want to show you before we move into the COVID part. Fun & Mall, it's a very old mall that Singapore has been rebuilding last year with new concepts such as co-working, co-living, fancy brands, cycling path indoor. It's really, with that kind of like a rooftop organic farming that will help to serve some of the restaurants inside in terms of greeneries and vegetables. Nomadex, very interesting concept in another mall in Singapore. And the purpose of that multi-department store is to bring successful online brands into the offline world. And so they have about 20 to 30 digital brands that they take and to make them experiment what offline is. In Singapore, we're a small country, hot country. There are malls everywhere. And the population loves to spend time outside in those kind of like a commercial area. So it's a very interesting way as well to play, everyone wants to go digital, but digital brands also want to come offline to have, a bit of exposure. Habitat used to be a very interesting concept store launched by a leading delivery and e-commerce company. The e-commerce side has been bankrupt, but they kept that kind of like a very connected convenience store / supermarket where, robotics would help you to take your goods after the cashier. Very interesting concept store. And Mahota is a concept store which is more on the topic of lifestyle and wellness. And they decided on top of the product to have like a very strong value proposition on the events, the community. They have like, courses that you can subscribe to, gyms, really to attract people, not just to buy the product, but to come as well for the service in the same brand universe of, let's have a healthy lifestyle. Live streaming has been also one of the new trends in the market coming from China. I think you may have heard that China is very strong on live streaming. It's a bigger industry than cinema and the box office over there. And now it kind of like spreads out all across Asia, especially for younger population who loves to just plug on Facebook, on TikTok, and to see the live streaming sometimes and increasingly of brands and retailers. So we're going to see an example a little bit later. And of course, we try as much as we can to get rid of the cash. As you can see, the cash transactions were decreasing by 5% a year over the last 3 years. And this year, of course, because of the COVID, the decrease is even more steep, 11% less of cash transactions. So people pay with, you know, mobile wallets that have been ramped up by the telecom operators, by the bank. And now even business-to-business transactions tend to happen more and more with that system. So, for example, my agency, we pay some of our providers directly with the mobile wallets, you know, which is not so common when you are in, you know, invoices between different businesses. How did Singapore react to the outbreak? We had three waves. The first wave was from, you know, travelers coming from Wuhan in China. Singapore is very well connected to China in terms of business. And so we got our first few cases from Chinese businessmen or Singaporean businessmen or women coming back from China with the virus. Second wave in February, March was more from European expats coming back from the ski holidays in Europe. At this time, Europe was still very, you know, unsure about what was happening, but cases were already there. And the third wave was with what we call migrant workers. Singapore has a population of about 200,000 migrant workers. They build the city, they clean the gardens, they do, you know, all the low-skill jobs. And of course, they stay in dormitories where the risk of contamination is bigger. So that's been the main driver, actually, of cases over the last few months here. There have been a number of initiatives done, you know, to prevent the contamination to go further. Disinfecting robots that were, you know, going around the malls and the dining centers to clean up the tables. Beam Pro robots to interact with the people that were in isolation so that, you know, they would have as less possible contact even with the healthcare staff when it comes to, you know, checking on their daily routine. Dog robots, I'm sure you have seen the news. Those little Boston Dynamics robots have been launched in Singapore 2-3 weeks back to, you know, remind people of the rules of social distancing. And we have also those kind of UV robots who are providing decontamination of the air around you guys without having to spray chemicals. So they are, you know, they are actually plugged onto this little rolling cart, which I'm sure you have seen in the warehouses of Amazon before. That's the same kind of little piece on the wheel, and it goes around with the UV to decontaminate the air around. So that's part of the thing that has been done here. The government has tried also to launch some initiative with this app that has been at the center of a debate in many countries, which is called Trace Together. The idea was to have people to download the app and to open their Bluetooth so that whenever you go out, you put the app open, and then, of course, the government is able to track wherever you go and to trace in case you have been close to someone that, you know, can have the virus, and to, you know, get the contact tracing in that way. It's been downloaded more than 1 million times in Singapore. The problem is that if you use the Bluetooth and the app, it has to be on the screen. So it means if you go on WhatsApp or YouTube or whatever, the app goes down behind and you lose a bit of efficiency. So at the end of the day, they kind of like let the app go, but they design a new system called Safe Entry, whereby you basically key in your IC card, your ID card, which has a barcode, and you scan it at the entrance of every cab, of every mall, of every retail outlet to say, I am here, I check in, or I check out. You can see here, for example, if you scan, either you scan a QR code with your phone, and your phone has your ID inside in Singapore, either you give directly your IC to a barcode scanner, and then you, the retail will know exactly where you are. So many countries are not comfortable with that solution because, you know, it's it takes on privacy, obviously. But for me, I don't see any issue. We have to get rid of that virus. I want to get out of my home. So of course, I think it's a system that makes sense and that's, you know, as efficient as can be in terms of tracing. A lot of things have been done as well on the digital transformation and to help the island to go more digital. So for example, a lot of money has been spent as well on educating the senior and the elderly to use apps and technology to stay at home and to order. Singapore is a developed country. We have a lot of elderly, and of course, the elderly have struggled to respect, you know, not going to the market because that's the only way they know how to do their groceries. So, you know, they have tried to do a lot of training so that the elderly could book their groceries from online or have access to younger people buying for them and delivering in their home instead of going themselves outside, because you, as we know, that's the population that is the most at risk in case they contact the virus, you know, have a little infection. The government has also tried to partner with the big e-tailers such as Lazada, Amazon, Shopee, and Qoo10. Those are the four largest e-commerce players in Singapore, to kind of like give a free package of onboarding for small businesses who wanted to open their online store for the first time. And basically, it's a $9,000, about 6,000 euro worth of goods, advertising, opening of the storefront online, so that, you know, any business, F&B, small biz, could open their first presence online if they didn't do so in the past. So that's a very good system as well. A lot of cash handouts. You know, they gave cash $300 to $600. It's about €200 to €400 to the population in cash payouts. And today, because actually this slide dates from last week, so in the meantime we have another slice of budget coming from the government. Today we are at 20% of the GDP given out to different types of incentives and schemes to the population or to businesses to, you know, keep the workforce at work and not to retrench anyone, and to try to make things go, you know, as smooth as possible in a country which is highly exposed to, you know, international trade. So the heat here is really very, very visible. Another incentive that was interesting has done with a wet market, the Tekka market. It's one of the wet markets in Little India, a very nice area in Singapore. They have pushed the retailers of, you know, vegetable, meat, fish to go to live streaming. So they organized the operation once, and the idea was to have about 20 sellers that were able on the schedule each, you know, in one row, to have like 5 minutes of live streaming to show the product and to have people to bid on the different package that the sellers were offering. That's one way, you know, to kind of digitize a very common place for local people to do their groceries. Trying to go to the next slide. Let's see a little bit how retailers have been able to adapt. So it's just, you know, the timeline. I think you will have those slides anyway of the measures and the reopening. So today we are in what we called the phase one, starting next week. So the phase one is basically almost like a lockdown. My son will be able to go back to school. But else than that, most businesses will remain closed for one more month. So the only thing I can do, which is new, which is to have my family coming to visit me, my in-laws, because if not, I need to stay only with my core family, with my wife and my son. The phase two will be ready when the businesses will be able to reopen for good. And the phase two will happen only in 1 month's time if things go well. Yesterday was the first day in Singapore where we had zero new cases of local population, but we still have 300 cases from the migrant workers. So the government says, you know, we prefer to do a strict lockdown for a long time, and we don't want to go back to a lockdown at all because we know it's complicated from an acceptance perspective. So right now we are still in that phase. And the phase three, which is the new normal, where pretty much every business can go normally, is not scheduled before the end of the year. So it means sports event, big conferences, and those events where you have like hundreds and hundreds of people, it's not planned at all for this year. So we'll still have to wait a little bit for that to happen. Some of the measures will stay probably for a long time, such as, you know, temperature check at every building, at every metro, every cab. Social distancing, we're going to start in a minute. Contact tracing as well, with the system of the safe entry, which I have shown you. No rush policy. Singapore is not in a rush to reopen too fast. They don't want at all to go back to the system of the lockdown because they know it's pretty hard for people to tolerate. And the gradual reopening of the businesses of the island. Some of the physical measures that have been implemented in the retail world, you know, one of the supermarkets had a list of the limitation of what a household could buy in one day at the supermarket. No more than $30 of poultry, $20 of vegetables, no more than 2 packs of instant noodles to avoid people to, you know, do the panic buy. You could see, of course, those lines of people panic buying, which is very counterproductive, because of course many people are waiting in a very close line, so you increase the risk of having virus. Many people were also abandoning their carts because the queue was too long, so you have a lot of waste and a lot of, you know, maintenance of the shop to do behind, so that's why they try to limit the orders per customer. You can have also the same type of, you know, social distancing with marks on the floor pretty much everywhere in the shop and at the cashier. Safe entry, you need to check in and check out with your phone so that, you know, if you have been in contact with someone that can have the virus, you will be easily traced by the government and put probably in isolation or stay home notice. Some retailers also try to you know, revamp the aisles so that you could have the type of products that are more needy at the start and at the cashier area. Temperature check, beyond 28 degrees Celsius, you cannot enter. Protective equipment for the cashier and the staff with, you know, the shield, not just the mask, but the protective shield. And of course, as we said, a limited number of goods that you could take in one go. Some of the online, some of the retailers, they had, of course, to go online. So Fair Price is the equivalent of the, you know, Tesco, for example, for us. It's the largest, probably, retailer Singapore owned. I don't think anyone was ordering online from them until now. They had to ramp up their capability and to hire people to, you know, face the increase of demand online. I think in Singapore, we had up to 1 week of waiting for online slots to have the delivery happen because, you know, all the systems were really overwhelmed by the demand. That has happened also in other markets. Fair Price, they also tried to get closer to their target, especially the elderly, with those kinds of vans that were going through some of the older districts in Singapore, where you would have 1/3 of elderly. And of course, trying to get, you know, all the key necessities for them instead of having the elderly taking the risk to come into the supermarket and get exposed to more people. You know, pre-order from home and pick up on WhatsApp. WhatsApp is one of the largest social media and messaging platform in Singapore, more than Messenger, for example. So people could just order on WhatsApp. Everybody's there, the elderly as well. And you could, you know, pick up at the nearby ESO gas station on the same day. So that's one thing as well that they do. It's not very high tech, but, you know, that's what works as well for a population which is connected to those kind of apps. You know, so a lot, 300% excess demand on 1 week for Redmart. Redmart is the online grocery of Singapore, part of Alibaba Group today. And that's on this website, for example, that you would have to wait up to 1 week to get a delivery slot because so many people were ordering as well. What happens as well on the dining scene? So now you cannot go for a dine-in. That picture was, you know, just what the normal dining looks like in Singapore. Today, everything is, of course, totally, you cannot go, you cannot stay. You can go and buy, but you need to take out, you cannot dine in. People, of course, want to go back. One of the measures is to implement the social distancing in those collective areas. So you can see people are lining up here to buy from that baking and cake shop. So they have, you know, like the small square where you can stay. And whenever they reopen the dine-in, you will have one seat out of two, which is, you know, you cannot sit on that to really have people to be 1 meter apart, at least when they are having a dine-in. Some strategies, this is the one we showed you before with that wet market that was, you know, organizing. Each vendor is given a 1 hour slot to sell the product. So they have the time to, you know, chit chat with the user that are on the other side of the phone. They can make some package. They can answer the questions live. And then after, you know, you see it's very manual, it's not very high tech. They have, you know, the bidders that are listed on a shared document. So Melvin Young has ordered 2 packets of maybe the fruits here. Milo Milo has ordered 1 packet. So, and after, of course, they will take the transactions offline. They will have the payment happen to one of the mobile wallets and have the delivery done the same day, free for more than $20 of spending. So that's what it would look like. One of the organizers of the live streaming is, you know, going through the stores, and, you know, that's the butcher trying to look at how he's doing his trade and trying to get a bit more order in that market. So many people thought it was very useful. And of course, for those type of sellers who are totally not connected to digital platforms, it's also a way to onboard and to get over there. That's been the same also for the Ramadan Bazaar. There is a significant side of the population in Singapore that is Muslim. People from Malaysia, Indonesia, part of the Indian community as well is Muslim. And of course, you know, the month of Ramadan just ended a week ago. And so most of those bazaars that are very lively, and you know, very, very fancy markets to go when it's Ramadan time, they all moved online as well, so that they could deliver all these goods fully online for this year. Some brands have also adapted the communication. You know, Mahota, that store that we have talked about, lifestyle product and wellness, they have, you know, this list of the most useful products that you can buy to fight the COVID in terms of getting your immune system as boosted as possible, spirulina, vitamin D. Some others, they have also shared about the effort that they make for their staff to protect them, because, you know, if you order from a shop, you want to know that that shop is safe as well. So yes, we do check the temperature of our associates. Yes, we do respect social distancing. Yes, we do the decontamination of all, you know, the items of the shop regularly. The online retailers as well have shown the type of partnership that they have done to give away part of their revenues to charities to solve the issues of having, you know, masks or paying the Red Cross some vouchers. So Zalora and Pomelo are two very big names in online fashion stores in Singapore and Thailand. And, you know, that's how they try to really give back to the community in terms of we are here to do business, but also, of course, to give back to those who need the mask and, of course, the Red Cross. Some strategies. I think one of the big challenges was for, you know, those mom and pop shop and restaurants to go with the delivery market. Delivery, as you know, takes about 30 to 35% of commissions, which is very high for the restaurants. They are not used to pay such a commission. And of course, if you order online from the Indian shop, you are not going to order alcohol. You buy the alcohol separately. So for the restaurant, it's less margin. So there has been a lot of petitions and you know, initiatives from the restaurant owner to tell the users, please help us to order directly from our website. Don't go always to the delivery guys, because we cannot make enough margin to sustain the business. It's been really a big issue for them today. So you have this Facebook group that is trying to rescue the small restaurants to you know, sales are down 90%. The food platform delivery are taking 30% of commissions. Please help us to book direct. That, you know, as much as they can do to try to reserve the business. Some restaurants have tried to pull together locally. They say, you know, we are five restaurants in the same street who are pulling together for the same delivery service, so that, you know, if you order from many of us, you only have one delivery fee. To be frank, it's very hard. I order a pizza actually from one of my favorite pizzeria. They decided not to go on those delivery platforms, but the way to order is really painful. I have to key in my credit card all the time. I don't have the tracing of the delivery guy. So last time they told me I would need to wait 60 minutes to be delivered. They delivered in 20 minutes. When you have a little baby at home, it's not really easy. I prefer to know exactly when the guy comes. I don't want the guy to come early or later. So it's a hard time for those guys to really try to overcome the convenience and, of course, the price of delivery platforms like Deliveroo or Grab. Some shops have tried to do virtual experiences. This, you know, Michelin starred restaurant tried to do the delivery with a staff with white gloves and a personal note from the chef. But now the delivery is contactless, so you cannot even do that. Some of the lifestyle, you know, and lounge restaurant, they try to do a bottle cocktail so that you can have like the same experience in-house of having a nice cocktail. Some of them have gone into organizing events, meditation sessions, live DJs to, you know, entertain you a little bit, because it's so boring to stay at home as well from a user perspective. But again, it's not so easy to do. So another bar here, Atlas, is one of the most beautiful bar, very art deco kind of spirit. They also try to do, you know, a cocktail in a bottle to really make people to order. But it's very hard really to order that. This one is one of the leading mother shops for, you know, when you're a parent and you need to buy stuff for your kid. They had zero presence online before the crisis, and now they try really to put some digital assistance to answer any questions. You know, if you're a young parent, you cannot just buy things. You need to have like reviews, you need to have like a guidance to help you to answer the most basic questions. So their revenues went down 70% since the crisis, but the online sales rose 4x compared to 2019. I think the problem is that 4x is not enough. When you start from almost zero, they could have done 10x. It's still not enough to compensate for, you know, people now are just buying on Lazada, Amazon, and the big platforms instead of having the pain to register to one new platform where the experience is not, you know, so interesting in terms of digital. To conclude, I guess the four parts that may be interesting for you is that, you know, how can you try to go to a direct-to-consumer strategy? It's very hard to be dependent from the delivery platforms. The second one is, how do you use the social media platform to create a live experience for your user and a nice experience in terms of customer relationship? The third one is, be sure that you communicate well on the measures you have taken to keep your shop and your business safe from the COVID, the business, and of course the employees. And of course, you know, what would be a strategy for people that are less connected online, such as the elderly, big markets in many, you know, developed economies in the world that are not so used to go on Amazon maybe and some of those shops. So that would be the four, I guess, recommendations we could give you that are inspired by what Singapore has tried to do to counter the COVID. Thank you for your attention and happy to take some of your questions.
Thanks a lot, Martin, for this great presentation. And we know better Singapore now. It's I was quite surprised of all of these things, in fact. So thanks a lot. It was quite very interesting. I have maybe one or two questions for you. First question, of course, it's about e-commerce. Have you seen the share of e-commerce grow, as in China or even in Europe? Is it the same trend in Singapore?
Yeah. I mean, I think for Redmart, for example, the online grocery, they have 300% more online, you know, demand than before. And I think until that, it used to be mostly expats and people with more money that were ordering, because many local people were still shopping at the corner store. But now a lot of local population, the elderly, like, you know, middle class, is also ordering now on that. So yes, of course, it has accelerated the penetration by, I mean, for that case, it's 300% more, and they were already the leader in grocery shopping, so they were starting not from zero.
Okay, thanks. And the second question is, because we are échangeurs, so we love startups, and from your point of view, which is the best startup to know for retail? You must see this startup at Singapore. You don't have the choice.
Yeah, I mean, in retail, I would say that Shopee is very interesting. S-H-O-P-E-E. You know, it's, I guess, the number two of e-commerce in terms of apps after Lazada. And Shopee actually is an interesting story because the mother company is one of the leading gaming company in Southeast Asia, and they are very strong on messaging as well. And they said, why don't we build e-commerce store, e-commerce marketplace, and the core of this marketplace is messaging and chatting between the seller and the buyer. So it's a very different proposal from Amazon, where, you know, the convenience is more like a one-click purchase, for example. For them, it's okay, we are very good at chat, let's build e-commerce on top of the chat. And today it's the number two of e-commerce in Southeast Asia. They actually have a deal with Ronaldo, the football player, to be their you know, brand ambassador in the region. So it shows you how far you can go when you are mobile first and really with that concept of chat as the main block of e-commerce. Conversational e-commerce is a way, if you want to call it that way.
Okay, thanks, Martin. We will go to Singapore to see it. We must go to Singapore now. And maybe the last question before to conclude. What about the user experience? What is the best user experience or best experiment for you in Singapore?
That's a good question. I guess in Singapore, the best experience would be with Grab. So Grab is the equivalent of Uber in Singapore. It's a ride-hailing app. And I think that it's inspiration from WeChat in China, where you can buy a lot of things on the app. You can not only buy, you know, your transportation, but today you can buy insurance, you can buy hotel rooms, you can buy, of course, food delivery. And I think the purpose of Grab is really that concept of super app, where you try to get as many parts of your digital life at one app only and not like 10 apps. I'm sure that next year I will be able to pay my son's infant care bills on Grab as well. They have the payment, they have the user, and now they really try to say, guys, you know, you can pay everything on our app. And that's very convenient, of course, from a user perspective, instead of having like 10 or 15 apps to do all of these, like, you know, fragmented kind of purchases.
Okay. Okay. Thanks. Thanks a lot. Thank you, Martin. It's time to go, unfortunately. And so thank you, everyone, for attending this second session of What's Hot In. You could watch the replay and the presentation in the next How Weekly newsletter. So thanks again, Martin. And take care, everyone. Thanks, Martin. Bye-bye.
Have a good weekend. Bye-bye.